Good evening. My name's Jim Walker. I'm the pastor of Revival from Down Under in the eastern suburbs of Melbourne, and Melbourne is in Australia. Tonight I'm going to speak on a topic called Blow the Trumpet in Zion. I've based this topic on what it says in Joel chapter 2 and in verse 1. So can we turn there, please? Joel chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord comes, and it is nigh at hand. Then it goes on to explain it's a day of darkness, etc., a day of clouds. And this is prophetically speaking of the time in which we now live. Just coming up to Christ's return is the day of the Lord. And so it's prophetic of that time. Now, before we go on with that, I'm going to come back to that. I want to, apparently there is a few going around, a few teachers are going around that are preaching that the Old Testament is not necessary. If it wasn't necessary, it wouldn't be in the book. You just have the New Testament, you wouldn't have the Old and New Testament. So the fact that it's in the book, it's necessary. And in Romans 15, verse 4, the Apostle Paul tells us, for whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. The things that were written aforetime are Old Testament scripture. And so Old Testament scripture was written by God. Men wrote it, but God spoke it. And it's for us, the church at this time, to learn from. You learn when you study. And in 2 Timothy 2:15, the apostle tells us, study to show yourself approved to God, rightly dividing the word. Hallelujah. So if you're not studying, you're not learning. And if you're not studying from all scripture, because of what it says in 2 Timothy 3 verse 16, all scripture is profitable for you, then you're not learning what God wants you to learn. If you're only studying New Testament, then you're only going to learn what's in the New Testament about Jesus. Yet the Old Testament has got more about Jesus than the New Testament. Jesus said so. Jesus said Moses wrote of him. And Moses wrote the first 5 books of the Bible. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And don't forget, there are 39 books in the Old Testament. There are only 27 in the New. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're also told by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 44 through 48, Paul tells us a principle of God, which is first the natural and that then afterwards that which is spiritual. When we study this principle, we find it runs throughout Scripture, and Jesus himself spoke by this principle when he spoke in parables. A parable being the use of natural things to represent that which is spiritual. So when Jesus spoke in parables, Jesus spoke by this principle of God, which was established by God. A good example of first the natural, then the spiritual, is the way Jesus spoke in the parable of the sower and the seed. Where we we find when we study it, the seed symbolizes or represents the Word of God, and the heart, the ground that the seed is sown into, represents the heart of man. Hallelujah. We also find that the conditions in the ground, they represent conditions within the heart. The hard ground, stony ground, thorny ground represent conditions within the heart that prevent the seed from producing the fruit that God requires. Hallelujah. Amen. We're also told in this parable in Mark 4, he says in verse 13, "Know ye not this parable, then how will you know all parables?" Parables, when you study the parables have been hidden since the foundation of the world. Parables are the mysteries of the kingdom. They are the secrets of the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And they are revealed and being revealed according to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 3 through 5. He revealed these mysteries through his senior ministries, the apostles and prophets. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Another word for parable, as we know, is also a proverb. And we know there's a full book of Proverbs. So if we don't understand the parable of the sower and the seed, Jesus is saying, how are you ever going to understand the book of Proverbs? And that key is symbolism. This parable is a key to understanding all parables. And that key is symbolism. Natural things representing that which is spiritual. Hallelujah. So, when we study Scripture, we find the Word of God is symbolized by many things. The Word of God is symbolized by many things. For example, the clearest ones that symbolize the Word are the manna, spoken of in Exodus 16:4, and in John chapter 6, Jesus said, "I am the true manna, I am the living bread, and Jesus is God the Word in flesh." So what he was saying is, I the Word am the manna, spoken of in Exodus 16 verse 4. Hallelujah. We also find rain symbolizes the Word of God. We also see a sword symbolizes the Word of God. Also water, and obviously a trumpet. For rain, we have Hosea 6. This is prophetic of Jesus Christ coming. It's prophetic of Jesus Christ. And it says in verse 3, "Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and he, the Lord, shall come unto us as the rain, unto us the former and the latter rain." Amen. Here, Jesus the Word, Jesus the full Word, is going to come unto us as the former and the latter rain. Well, that's two rains. And when we study God's Word is two testaments, a former and a latter. So the former and latter rain are prophetic of the Old and New Testament, the two testaments. Amen? Glory to God. Both speaking of Jesus Christ. Glory to God. Also in Hebrews chapter 4 concerning the sword. Hebrews chapter 4 concerning the sword. And in verse 12, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So here, the word of God is likened to a two-edged sword. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. In Ephesians 5, verse 25 through 27, it says we are washed by the water of the word. So water to wash in is also likened to and symbolizes the word of God. That's in Ephesians chapter 6, 5, verse 25 through 27. We are washed by the water of the word to make us without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. Hallelujah. If we are not hearing the word, we're not being washed in it. We have to hear the word for it to wash us. And when I talk about hearing the word, I am not talking about hearing it with these things that are stuck on the side of our head. I'm talking about hearing it in here when it becomes a life-giving word to you. When it quickens to you, then it's life-giving, and that's when it's washing you. That's when it's doing its work. Amen. In Revelation concerning the trumpet, Revelation chapter 1, it says of Jesus, verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice of the trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega. So here Jesus, the Word, speaks. His voice sounds like a trumpet. This is his voice. This is his voice. And it sounds like a trumpet. And it needs to be blown. Hallelujah. Amen. Also in Isaiah, if we go to Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah 58. This is to whoever reads it. This is not just, you know, it's in the book, and if you're reading it, it's speaking to you, and it says in verse 1, cry aloud, spur not, lift up your voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgressions, and the house of Jacob their sins. I think the problem arises when pastors who are called to blow the trumpet are not doing what they're called to do. They preach a soft gospel and they don't preach the full gospel, because when the larger your church gets, the more reliant the church is on the offerings and the tithe. And if we don't begin by teaching and preaching the truth in its fullness, and we start doing it at a later date, there is a good possibility you'll lose most of your congregation. And if you lose your congregation, you lose the money. So people, pastors are deceived into not preaching truth. They may not even have the truth to preach. God knows. The full truth anyway. Amen. So we are required, and I believe everybody is required to blow the trumpet at some stage in the life, but mainly the ministries are called to blow the trumpet, and we'll see that shortly. In Psalm 47, and in verse 5 it says, God is gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Hallelujah. Even if you go, there's another one if you, in Exodus 19, when God spoke on the top of the mountain, his voice sounded like a trumpet. And the trumpet was sounding long. Hallelujah. Amen. I would like you to turn to Numbers chapter 10. Numbers chapter 10. Here in Numbers chapter 10, the Lord speaks unto Moses and tells him to make a trumpet. This trumpet, when we read in verse 2, it says, make thee two trumpets of silver of one piece. Again, we read before, two reins, and the word of God is two testaments. If the trumpet is what we're saying it is, the word of God, then these two trumpets also represent both Old and New Testament, both Old and New, two trumpets. These two trumpets were made out of silver, and they were for calling of the assembly and for the journeyings of the camps. They were also, if you read on, they also were used in the feasts of the Lord. They were also used to blow on the feast of the Lord. Amen. Verse 3 says, when they shall blow with them, all the assembly shall assemble themselves to thee at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. So here, the first purpose that we see is for the trumpet to be blown to assemble the people to the tabernacle door. Now, the door of the tabernacle is Jesus Christ. Because the door of the tabernacle was the way to the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant speaks of the Godhead sitting on his throne. And the way to the Ark of the Covenant was through the door. And the way to God the Father is through the door. Jesus said, I am the door. He also said in John 14, I am the way to the Father. Amen. Glory to God. So we approach God through the door, and it's the trumpet that calls us to the door, and this speaks of what? It speaks of salvation. It speaks of our salvation. Being drawn to the door speaks of our salvation. Amen. In verse 9 it says, and if you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, then you shall blow an alarm. So here now we find that when the enemy is busy, an alarm has to be blown. And so lift up your voice as a trumpet and blow the word. You've got to defeat the enemy, we have to speak the word. Jesus, when he was tempted in the wilderness, he said, it is written. He spoke the word. And when we speak the word, we are blowing the trumpet in whatever capacity we need to blow it in. Amen. And I can tell you, Satan isn't deaf. He hears it when you blow it. And especially when you blow it in faith. Especially when you blow it in faith. Who blows the trumpet? Well, we're told in verse 8. The sons of Aaron, the priests, shall blow the trumpet. So the sons of Aaron, they prophetically speak of and symbolize the ministries of God. So it's the ministries of God that are called to blow the trumpet, not only as an alarm, but also to draw for salvation purposes. Every ministry has the capacity, even if you're not a ministry, you have the capacity of reconciliation, because that's what we have. Scripture says we have the ministry of reconciliation. Amen. So every one of us has the capacity to blow the trumpet in some form or another, either to draw to Jesus or even to tell somebody else of their faults. Scripture says if somebody has a fault, go and tell them. And if they don't hear you, take somebody else with you. That in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word should be established. So even then, the trumpet is being blown as an alarm, as a warning, because that's exactly what the word alarm means. The word alarm means a warning. Amen. Glory to God. In fact, the Oxford English Dictionary says of the word alarm as a warning. And it also says of it, it is a device that sounds a warning. So an alarm is, so the device that sounds the warning is the silver trumpet. Hallelujah. And the alarm, the sound of the alarm comes from the trumpet. Amen. When it's blown. The trumpet is the device that sounds the alarm. Glory to God. Amen. That's pretty easy to understand, isn't it? Glory to God. Back in Joel 2, back in Joel chapter 2, I just want to have a look at a couple of things here. It says, blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm, a warning, in my holy mountain. So here we have Zion is God's holy mountain, where the alarm has to be sounded. Now, when we study Scripture, there are scriptures that tell us that refer to mountains as being kingdoms. And we know God has a kingdom. So if we have a look in Psalm 30, this is why we study the word. We study, and as we study, we're being approved of God. In Psalm 30 and in verse 7, it says, Lord, David speaking, says, Lord, by thy favor, you hast made my mountain to stand strong. Speaking of Israel. speaking of natural Israel, you have made my mountain to stand strong. In Revelation 17, verse 9 through 10, Revelation 17, verse 9, he's the man which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains, and there are seven kings. Amen. So these seven mountains, these seven heads, seven mountains, are seven kingdoms. Amen. Glory to God. In Psalm 48, this is concerning the city of God. Psalm 48, verse 1. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. God is known in her palaces for a refuge. So here, this city of God, Zion, is referred to as a her. As a her. Amen. In Revelation 21, Revelation 21, it says of the bride of Christ, says of the bride of Christ, verse 2, and I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem. This is the city of God. This is Zion. Coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So here the city of God is likened to a woman, this woman being the bride of Christ. It also says in verse 9, there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. He carried me away into the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious. Hallelujah. Her light. Glory to God. Hallelujah. This is speaking of the bride of Christ, who we're told in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20, 26 through 27, 25 through 27, that she is without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. She is perfect. She is just like him. She is full of his glory. She is full of his glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Again, I say, back in Joel 2, verse 1, sound an alarm. Again, I say, the Oxford Dictionary says of the word alarm, it is a warning sound giving notice of danger. A warning sound giving notice of danger. Many people, older people especially, carry some form of alarm on them, just in case something goes wrong, and they can sound it. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. When, in fact, my mother-in-law, who is now coming up to 91, and she's quite frail, she's had a few falls. She lives on her own. She's had a few falls, broke quite a few bones in her body. And so now we have her, we have a thing that she carries around her neck that she presses if she's in trouble. And when she presses it, it sounds an alarm in the company, and they know there's something wrong. And so then wheels get into motion. Amen. In Ezekiel 33, if we turn there, see, if you don't preach from all Scripture, and if you don't believe in preaching from all Scripture, well, you can never reach, you can never achieve what God's got, the full call on our lives. It's impossible. But then, if you're not preaching all Scripture, then this doesn't apply to you. Or you think it doesn't apply to you, because you can't change what's already been written. Because it's been written, it applies to you. Amen. So in chapter 33, verse 1, again the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of the people, and say unto them, when I bring a sword upon the land. Who brings the sword? God does. What's the sword? The word. The word is the sword. Hallelujah. God is going to bring the sword on the land at the end. Because when I bring the sword on the land, hallelujah, where's the sword coming on the land? Anybody tell me where the sword coming on the land? What about Revelation 19? Out of his mouth goes a two-edged sword to destroy the nations. Do you want to look at that? Just keep your hand in Ezekiel and go to Revelation 19. Revelation 19. Verse 11. I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him were called Faithful and True. In righteousness he does make war, does judge and make war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head many crowns. He had a name written that no man knew but himself. He's clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. The armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, clean and white, and out of his mouth went a sharp sword. Out of his mouth went a sharp sword. This is the sharp sword that's coming on the land, on them that don't want to live according to his word. Hallelujah. If I bring the sword upon the land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him for the watchman. Hallelujah. The watchman. This is back in Ezekiel 33, verse 2. The watchman. Any watchman speaks of a ministry that God has set up God has established. Hallelujah. If when he sees the sword come upon the land and he blow the trumpet and what? And warn the people. Then whosoever hears the sound of the trumpet and takes not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. Well, the sword's coming. And them that don't pay heed to the word of God, whether they're Christians or not, it will come upon their heads. This is talking about the people of God. If the people of God take a man and make him a watchman. Verse 5. He heard the sound of the trumpet, and he took not warning. His blood shall be upon him. But he that takes warning shall deliver his soul. That's very clear, isn't it? But if the watchman, that's the ministry, sees the sword come and blows not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. So thou, O son of man, I have set you as a watchman. This is speaking to Ezekiel. Ezekiel was a prophet of God. He was one of God's ministries. And all the ministries have been set up to be watchmen. So thou, O son of man, I have set thee as a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore thou shalt hear the word of my mouth. This is the word of God's mouth. This is the word of God's mouth. You shall hear the word of my mouth and warn them. At this time, I would like to say to the people on the camera, it is not once saved, always saved. It is a wrong teaching. Whether false or through lack of understanding, he knows. But it is a wrong teaching. There's nowhere in Scripture that says it's once saved, always saved. In fact, if you carry on reading this chapter, it says in verse 12, Therefore, thou son of man, say unto the children of your people, the righteousness of the righteous shall not deliver him in the day of his transgression. As for the wickedness of the wicked, he shall not fall thereby in the day that he turns from his wickedness. Neither shall the righteous be able to live for his righteousness in the day that he sins, he will die. When I shall say to the righteous that he shall surely live if he trusts to his own righteousness and commit iniquity, all his righteousness shall not be remembered, but for his iniquity that he has committed, he shall die. Doesn't matter how we start our walk in God. It's not about how we start, it's how we finish our walk in God. Hallelujah. If we don't finish the race, we won't make it. If you enter a race, you've never finished till you've crossed the line. Anytime you pull out before you cross that tape, you've not finished the race. And so you don't get a reward. Hallelujah. Glory. And you can read the rest of that chapter. And also, if you read Ezekiel 19, it says Ezekiel 18, sorry. If you read all Ezekiel 18, it talks about the same things. The righteous, if he sins, shall die. The unrighteous man, if he repents, shall live. And God is no respecter of persons. Once you start, he expects you to spinach. To finish. Not spinach. To finish. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. Now there's probably other scriptures I could use in the Old Testament. But are the scriptures in the New Testament where a warning or an alarm is sounded? Well, I believe there is. In fact, if we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and it says in verse 10 and 11, now all these things happened unto them, that's natural Israel, for ensamples, that is types or patterns, and they are written for our admonition, that is warning, upon whom the ends of the world have come. That is certainly not speaking to the Corinthian church. That is the church in this generation. Paul clearly says, upon whom the ends of the world have come. That is this generation, not that. Carrying on in verse 12. Wherefore, let him that thinks he stands take heed, unless he falls. So we can fall from where we are. Amen. Who says that? Paul does. This is the great apostle Paul speaking. Again, I say, it is not once served, always served. What is the warning? They are written for our admonition. What is the warning? The warning is what happened to natural Israel from verse 1 through 10. If you read what happened to natural Israel from verse 1 through 10, God is saying, don't you do these same things. In fact, it said many of them committed fornication. In verse 8, neither let us commit fornication, as some of them did. So if you, just as an example of that, if you go back into 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and in verse 9 he says, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators. There it is. Fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminates, abusers of themselves with mankind, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revelers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. So here, Paul's warning us in 1 Corinthians 10, but he also tells us in 1 Corinthians 6, if you do these things, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. To me, that is pretty clear that it's not once served, always served. He says, you will not if you do any of these things. You will not, you will not, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And there are many, many more scriptures I could read to you saying the same thing. Paul preached a doctrine like that. Not once saved, always saved. He said, if you do these, you'll go to hell. And yet them coming along, preaching another doctrine, a doctrine that is not, a doctrine that Paul did not preach, and that doctrine is once saved, always saved. And it is a deception. Hallelujah. Do not get caught with it. many well. Many, many well. When we study Scripture according to what the Apostle tells us to do, we find Scripture reveals that there is a natural Israel and there is a spiritual Israel. There is a natural Jew and there is a spiritual Jew. The natural Israel and spiritual Israel are shown in Genesis chapter 13 and 15 with the promised seeds of Abraham. The first seed being his natural seed, the second seed being his spiritual seed. Then in Romans, we're told about two Jews. Romans chapter 2. He's not a Jew, there is one outwardly, but he is a Jew, there is one inwardly, and circumcision is of the heart. Romans 2 verse 28 and 29. Hallelujah. So here we have natural Israel, spiritual Israel, a natural Jew and a spiritual Jew. And what Paul is referring to in 1 Corinthians 10 is the natural Jew. We are not to do what the natural Jew did. Otherwise, judgment will come upon us just the same. Because God is no respecter of persons. Hallelujah. In Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1. Now, I could read all the chapter. In verse 9, it says might. In verse 10, it said that you might walk. Hallelujah. Might is set in a condition that you might. There's a condition being set. It then says, in verse 23, if, verse 22, in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if you continue in the faith, grounded, settled, be not moved away from the gospel, etc. Amen? Not one saved, always saved. Then if we go back down into verse 28, it says, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom that you may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Why are we being warned if it's once saved, always saved? Why are pastors not blowing the trumpet? God will judge them for not blowing the trumpet. They could even miss out on getting to heaven if they do not repent. Hallelujah. The word warning comes from the same Greek word as for admonition in 1 Corinthians 10 verse 11. It's the same Greek word for admonition. Admonition and warning meaning the same thing. Hallelujah. In 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, I'll read from verse 12. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you. So, brethren, know them that labor among you. Who are the ones that labor among you? The ministries are them that are doing stuff. Amen? Know them that labor among you and are over you in the Lord. And what? And admonish you. They admonish you. They actually admonish you with what? With this. This is what they admonish you with. They admonish you with the word. Admonishing, warning, bringing correction, etc., etc. Amen. I'll carry on reading. And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Amen. Glory to God. Verse 14. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly. Warn them that are same word, same Greek word. Comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient towards all men. See that no render evil for evil unto any man. Amen. God is the judge. God is the judge, and he's watching us all the time. Hallelujah. In Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6. And in verse 4, Paul says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. This can speak of natural families, natural mums and dads, but I also see spiritual fathers. Amen. Bringing up their children in the admonition of the Lord. Amen. Amen. 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. In verse 14 through 16. I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. For though you are 10,000 instructors in Christ, you have yet not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. That's what Paul says. Be ye followers of me. Do not be followers of another. In fact, there's another scripture that I've just thought of that I have not got written down. In Acts chapter 20. I'll read from verse 26. Paul says, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore. You know what that word heed means? Do you know what take heed means? Warning. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after themselves. Therefore watch and remember that the space of 3 years I cease not to what? To warn you every day and every night with tears. This is the church at Ephesus he's speaking to. He's also speaking to you because he's speaking to the church today through the Word of God. Amen. In Galatians. Galatians chapter 1. Here from verse 6 through 9, it says, if any come to you with another doctrine, don't follow them. Don't follow them. Don't listen to anybody that preaches another doctrine. A doctrine that is not according to the doctrine of Paul. Hallelujah. Amen. It's where many young people get caught out when they first get saved, because all they want to do is look on the internet for what other churches are doing, and they get caught with false teachings because they're not mature enough to know the difference. Hallelujah. Reading other books. When you first get saved, you don't need to read any other books. You just need to read the books in this one. This is the only book you read. You need get to know this so that you'll know that which is false. Amen. Amen.